Well, thank you very much for coming. It is a very big pleasure for me to introduce Professor Michel Terrat from the University of Limoges. He is currently emeritus professor at this university, but before this he reached the highest category, the exceptional class professorship in France. I visited MatSciNet 2 days ago, and I found 114 publications with 887 cites by 227 authors. So I think that these numbers speak for themselves. I was trying to remember when was the first time we met. I think maybe in Puebla, in Mexico, in 2002. And thinking after that, we also met in Lumini in this conference you organized. I think so. So it's a long time from them. So okay, welcome, and we are yours.
Okay, thank you, Juan. Muchas gracias. And of course, I am very happy, more than happy. I don't know what is more than happy, but to be here and again. And as you know, I am a member also of your research group in some way. And so it's a pleasure to work with you and with our colleagues also from Alicante. I am trying to come at least every year, and so thank you very much for your invitation. And today I will speak in Spanish a little bit. Sobre versiones extendidas del teorema de punto fijo de Danks et Jedus Medvedev. This is difficult to pronounce. But in order to do so, I will speak a part of the lecture. The final part of the lecture will be joint work with a former student of Boris Mojovic. And but I want to talk a little bit about give some background on Lacan's variational principle and some of its application. And so I prepare a brief survey for that. And also after, I will give the motivation of the main talk, and which is, as I said, related to this theorem, Danks et Jedus Medvedev fixed point theorem. But in order to talk about this theorem and to make a clear presentation of the theorem, I need to also to remind you, probably to remind, because it's not so well known, basic things on quasimetric spaces, definition, basic property, example. Then, I hope I will have enough time, because the lecture is scheduled for 2 hours. And so you brought your lunch, I suppose. And then the main result and the conclusion, okay? So I will start with the Eklund variational principle. So you know Ivar Eklund is a very famous mathematician, and he is very well known and well established in the optimization and variational analysis community. He is known, of course, for his celebrated variational principle, but also for many other things, and in particular for the use of the Shapley-Folkman lemma in optimization theory. And also he is still working in finance, in mechanics, and he has also, from the point of view of optimization, contributed to the periodic solution of Hamiltonian systems. And since he came back from Canada, he was the head of the mathematical group in Vancouver. He is working in finance and using optimization, but not only optimization, to finance stuff. So beside of this, he is a good friend to me. he's invited. I hope he will come.
You are invited to come even if you don't pay for it.
Okay, so the following fact is important. One of the most powerful tool in variational analysis is the Eklund variational principle, in short EVP. And this principle asserts in essence that given a lower semi-continuous re-extended real valued function on a metric space, its epsilon minimizer that always exists whenever epsilon is strictly positive, it is possible to perturb both the function and the given point so that the new point gives an exact global minimum for the perturbed function. So I will, in fact, write more precisely one of the version, the version of the Eklund variational principle. So you start with ED, a complete metric space, D is a distance, and F an extended real valued function, suppose proper, lower semi-continuous, and bounded below, okay, which means that the infimum is not infinity. And note that for every epsilon, we have always, by the definition of the infimum, a new epsilon in E, such that this star inequality holds, the infimum is less than F of F U epsilon, and strictly less than the infimum plus epsilon. And the EVP asserts that under these, all these assumptions, but the completeness is very important in this theorem, for every U satisfying this star inequality and for every lambda strictly positive, you always have some V in E such that F of V is less than F of U, the distance between U and V is less than lambda, and if V, W is different from V, the image of W by F is strictly greater than F of V minus epsilon over lambda, the distance of U between U and V. And in fact, the proof of this theorem, the initial proof, was based on a device due to Bishop Phelps, and which was the same trick than Theurer-Kafelaer, for instance, use when establishing the Spoon-Rockefeller theorem. But in fact, I will give you, because I'm starting slowly, the idea, the sketch of the in fact, it's another proof. It's not the initial proof. Okay? But you start with a partial, to define a partial ordering on E by setting these things that U is less than or equal to V if and only if F of U is less than F of V minus D lambda of U and V, where you replace the distance D by 1 over lambda D. Okay? And you start with an algorithm. You start with U1 equal U bar, and you set this first set S1, and then you pick U2 in this set such that you have this inequality, which is always of course possible, and inductively you define a sequence of set Sn such that U is less than un, un plus 1 belongs to S of Sn, like you see, like here, and F of un plus 1 is less than or equal to the infimum of F over Sn plus epsilon over 2 to the n plus 1. And then you construct by this way a decreasing sequence of closed sets with a diameter going to zero, and you know that it's a basic things in metric spaces when they are complete, which is the case here, and it is important at this point that there is a unique point in the intersection, and the point which is in the intersection is exactly the point we are looking for in this theorem. Okay, this is the constructive proof of the Eklund variational principle. Okay, but there is another famous theorem in the literature which is called the Karisti fixed point theorem, and which was proved independently of Eklund and before Eklund theorem, which is related to fixed point of a set-valued mapping. So you have a set-valued mapping from E to E, and you make the assumption that f of y is less than f of x minus d of the distance between x and y.
F is d, no?
Sorry?
F is d. Here?
I don't.
F.
No. You suppose you have a function. No, t is a set-valued function. Okay, you have a function. It's written in a condensed way. Okay, you have a function from from x from e to r, which satisfies this. So this f of y, f of y is less than f of x minus the distance of x and y for every x in e and for every y belonging to the set t of x. F is a function from x to r. Okay. And also the setting is the same, you have a complete metric space, okay? And then the characteristic fixed point theorem says that in this under this assumption, T has a fixed point. It means that there is an X such that X belongs to T of X, okay? Because T goes from E to the subset of E.
And what condition is required to fix a mapping T?
Is a
no,
it is a lowest
continuous, I suppose.
Okay, under the same assumption, I forgot to write of the Eklund variation principle. And so, but after Eklund proved his theorem, it has been shown that the Eklund variation principle and the characteristic fixed point theorem, in fact, are equivalent. And in fact, in order to prove this, I just give a very short proof of that, the idea. In the Eklund variation principle, you take epsilon equal 1, and from the Eklund variation principle, you obtain this. And so it's clear that x0 belongs to t of x0, and otherwise, if y is distinct from x0, we have this and a contradiction. So you, from Eklund variational principle, from the Eklund variational principle, you easily prove that there is a fixed point of t. And conversely, you change a little bit, you transform the distance, you set delta equal epsilon d, which is an equivalent distance, of course, and so, with this distance, the space is always complete. And so you suppose, by contradiction, that there is no u epsilon satisfying the Eklund variational principle, and you arrive easily to a contradiction. So it is very easy to pass from one theorem to the other one, and they are effectively equivalent. Okay? And in fact, also, you can obtain from this the Banach-Picard fixed point theorem. Okay, if you have a contraction f from x to x, and if you set this function, so you just apply, which is one over, which is a contraction with k. You say f of x minus norm of f of x minus f of y is less than k, the norm of x minus y. Okay. I have no need to write this, I suppose. And so with k, between 0 and 1 in contraction, so f of x minus f of y less than equal to k, f. This is a contraction, okay? And then, under the same assumption, of course, completeness of the space and so on. And in this case, the function is continuous. It's not more than low continuous, but continuous. And then you apply, and you have also a proof of the from Eklund or from the characteristic fixed point theorem. You have a proof, an easy proof of the Banach contraction principle. Okay. This is a way to see this. Also, from Eklund, you can say more if you have more assumption on F. And if F, under the same assumption, if F is Gatow differentiable, you have also an indication on the Gatow derivative. Or on the Fréchet derivative, if the function is differentiable on the gradient, okay? So you are bound on the gradient. Also from Eklund, you have many other things which are very interesting. I go there very quickly. If you have a Banach space, a C1 functional on X, and the Paris-Mel condition says that every sequence un which satisfies that the norm of phi of un is bounded by a constant and the derivative tends to zero, then the sequence has necessarily a convergence sequence. Okay? By using the Eklund variational principle or the characteristic fixed point theorem, you can prove that if you have a functional C1 bounded below, if the Paris-Mel condition is satisfied, of course, then the function attains its minimum at a critical point. Okay? And in fact, this, you have a lack of compactness, of course, and this replaces this lack, the Paris-Mel condition replaces the lack of compactness. Or coercivity, in fact. Okay? And also from the Eklund variational principle, it is why it is very important, you can obtain the famous mountain pass theorem, which is the following. So if you have a Banach space, a functional phi, which is C1, and which satisfies the Paris-Mel condition, and suppose there exists X bar and R satisfying this, then you have a critical value C such that C is the infimum over all the paths going to X bar to C, to R. From zero to, sorry, to X bar. And the essential proof of the mountain pass lemma is proved by using the Eklund variational principle. So I just did this background just to mention that the Eklund variational principle is one of the most important theorems. And I will list here all the applications. So the infinite dimensional mountain pass theorem of Ambrosetti and Rabinowitz. They are the king ingredient in new variational principle, Bowen and Price, Deville, Godefroy, Zisler variational principle. It has provided simple and elegant proof of known results such that the characteristic, just I said, the drop theorem of Danesh, the Takahashi theorem about the existence of minibar, the petal forward theorem of Penno, the Krasnoselsis-Abricot theorem on the solvability of operators' equations, and the Phelps lemma. And so, as you will see in this list, Eklund variational principle, which has been done incidentally, because I know very well Eklund, and it was just a small lemma for him to prove a result he has in mind, which was related to PDEs, by the way, at this time. And so, but after, he saw that not only him, but many people after him saw that this Ekman variational principle is a foundation of many results in mathematics. But now, this has been done for mappings, for functions. But people, of course, have think to extend this variational principle to set-valued mapping, okay? To vector minimization, Pareto minimization. And many people have worked on this. They are not, all are not listed here, but it started, in fact, I think, with Loridan in 1984. Loridan was in Dijon, a professor in Dijon. This, I don't know this guy, but I know that he was working in this area. Can, which is a Vietnamese in Saigon, a friend of Dean. Can again, Hamel, a German. These are German people. Kui, which is a student of Can. Göpfer, German. And Zanidescu, and many others, okay? And more recently, my co-author, which was, as I said in the introduction, a former student of Boris Mordukovych, Bao and Mordukovych, did some result in this direction in complete metric spaces, okay? And also, somebody in the Institute of Mathematics, it is a woman, huh? In the Institute of Mathematics in Vietnam, had produced many papers on extension of the Ekman variational principle to set-valued mapping. And she was using, I think she was the first to use as a main ingredient to prove an extension of the Ekman variational principle of this Danks, Hedgedus, Medvedev theorem, fixed point theorem. Okay? And it is also, you can, if you have this book of Tamer, Can, Tamer, Zaninescu, you can read inside many many historical comments about this thing. Okay, and so now I was talking during 25 minutes on Ekman variational principle. I think it's time to go to the which was at the beginning the main talk, the main subject of the talk. So, my motivation, our motivation of extended version in quasi-metric space of the Medvedev theorem, Danks, Hedgedus Medvedev theorem, and also adopted in order to obtain some new type result, Ekman variational principle on for multifunctions in quasi-metric spaces comes from a new way to modelize adaptive dynamical models of behavioral sciences as worthwhile approach of avoidance dynamics. Okay, an adaptive dynamic starts from an undesirable initial state, follow acceptable transition defined as succession of worthwhile states and changes, trying to approach and reach a desired end, some desire, or to avoid the undesirable initial state. At each step, it is worthwhile to change if motivation to change is proportionally higher than resistance to change. Okay, and the inconvenience to change are modelized now by what we call quasi-metrics. I will give more information about this. So it is important to emphasize that it is more practical if an inconvenience to change from one state to another equals that from the later state back to the former one. And so this model have been has been given for to modelize problems in psychology, capability theory of well-being, and organizational change, respectively. And there are many papers, some papers, not many, by Boris Mordikovich, Bao, and all these students. Okay? And go. Okay, so the starting point is this theorem. For simplicity, I will call it DHMFPT, because it's very difficult to pronounce these things. Okay, so the theorem is the following. You start with a complete metric space, and you take phi, a set-valued mapping, which satisfies four conditions. A1, phi of x is always a closed set in for every x, okay, in x. X belongs to phi of x for every x. And A3, if x2 belongs to phi of x1, then phi of x2 is included in phi of x1. Okay? And now, for each generalized Picard sequence, which means xn of x, xn of phi, which means that xn plus 1 belongs to phi of xn, then the limit between xn and xn plus 1 goes to 0 when n goes to plus infinity. Then, if you start to a point x0 in x, you have a convergent sequence xn whose limit e x star is a fixed point of phi. Okay? So, this is the DHMFPT theorem. Okay? And, okay, maybe I will go fast on this. Kahn and his student Kui presented some extension of this theorem in order to establish a new version of the Eklund variational principle for what they call weak tau function. And weak tau function is a b function, it means that it is defined in the Cartesian product of x by itself, and which satisfy triangle inequality, lower semi-continuity, and also some other property, tau 3 and tau 4, which are, but I don't want to spend time on this. And with in this direction, if you have a metric space, and if P is a weak tau function as it was defined before, and phi is a set-valued mapping, suppose given a generalized Picard sequence xn convergent to x bar with respect to P, in the sense that the limit when n goes to plus infinity of P of xn h bar goes to zero, then with this three property b1, b2, b3, so the inclusion of phi of xn plus 1 is included in phi of xn, the limb of the supremum of P of xn and u for u belonging to phi of xn goes to zero, and x bar is in x phi of xn for every n, then the intersection of all the phi of xn reduces to a single point x bar. Okay, this is the theorem of Kahn and Kui. If in addition you have this condition, then phi x bar is an invariant point of phi, which means that for phi of x bar reduces to x bar. So the phi of x bar is a singleton, reduces to x bar. Okay, so this I can go fast because it's well known for everybody. So you have it's the concept of preorder, reflexivity, transitivity, antisemitivity. Okay, so this is this is called when you have a relation which satisfy reflexivity, transitivity, antisemitivity. It is called a preorder. Okay, and so there is another result due to Q alone. If you have a preordered space set, and you consider the level set mapping S of S with respect to the preorder less than equal. I don't know what to say for that. Then level set mapping, it means that you consider the set of U which are less than X. Okay? You start with X naught in X, such that this level set is non-empty, and you consider a mapping phi, small phi, from X to R bar, monotone with respect to the preorder, and you suppose that you have this condition C1, C2, and C3. Okay, this is a little bit technical. I will not spend too much time here. The theorem in essence says that you have a point X bar which belongs to the level set with respect to X naught, and you have that this condition for X bar. So this is not really very important. Now I want to spend more time because this is not so well known. About quasimetric. So a quasimetric space, which has many terminology for that, okay? For instance, it's called also quasi-pseudometric by some people. So what is you have Q, B function from X times X with only the two properties. You have positivity, it's close to a distance, but it is not a distance. Q of X and X prime is positive, and Q of S and X equals zero. Okay? But you don't have, if Q of X and Y equals zero, X equals Y, necessarily. So you have this positivity, and you have the triangle inequality. Okay? So you have only a part of the distance, not a distance. Okay? And, but, which I was surprised when I started to study this, these pseudometric spaces are important. Because there, if you look at Google, you will see they have a abundant literature devoted to distance where the requirement of symmetry is omitted. Okay? For instance, I give you two real-life examples. The first one, which is not a mathematical, but just to think. Given a set of mountainous villages, the typical working times between element of X form a quasimetric because traveling up hills takes longer than traveling downhill. Just think to this. It's true, at least for me. But I think for everybody. Another simple example, a geometric topology having one-way street where a path from a point A to B comprises a different set of street than a path from B to A. This is true again. Okay? So, these metrics have some interest in topology by themselves, but they are also used in applied mathematics in the calculus of variation. For instance, Bao and Hall, Mordukovic, and use it for some mathematical models arising in some area of behavioral sciences. Because it seems that in these theories, everyone agrees that the cost to change in these models does not satisfy the symmetry property. Okay. Several terminology are used for the concept of quasimetric. For instance, this guy working in calculus of variation in Italian uses asymmetric distance. Kobzas really speak about quasi-pseudometrics. Deza et all use quasi-semimetric. This Milke Minik employs the name of dissipation distance. So if you look at this paper in internet, you will see many terminology which are different. And of course, if you have symmetry, you have a metric. And part two in the previous definition of quasimetric was first formalized by Frechse and later treated by Hausdorff, okay, which is this book, in fact, is considered as the foundation of the theory of topological and metric spaces. And you have, if you are interested in this, this guy has written a large survey on this. Okay, so some example of quasimetrics. The Sorgenfrey quasimetric on R, which is given by this. This quasimetric describes the process of filing down a metal stick. It is easy to reduce its size, but it is difficult or impossible to grow it. Okay, the quasimetric, for instance, this is a quasimetric on R. This is a quasimetric, the real half line, quasi semimetric, defined by this. But interesting is this is what we call the circular railroad distance. Imagine a circular railroad, okay, line, which moves only in a counterclockwise direction around a circular track, represented by the unit circle, S1. So the circular railroad quasimetric from any point x in S1 to any other point y in S1 is simply the counterclockwise circular arc length from x to y. And so this is a quasimetric also. Okay, you have also many other things, but when you have a quasimetric, you can consider the topology generated by these balls, balls in between guillemets, for instance, you have two kinds of balls. You have this ball and this ball, Q and Y, and Q and Y, okay? And Y and X. And these balls are called forward and backward balls, okay? And you have respect to the order of the variable in Q, you generate two topology and two notions of convergences. So you have to be careful of that. And so you have, as I said, the backward convergence and the forward convergence. So you see the variable are switched. Okay? So you have two kinds of, you have to be, so similarly, you have definition of Cauchy sequences. You have forward Cauchy and backward Cauchy. Okay, so you see, there is only the difference is you have to switch variable. Okay, because you have no symmetry, like in metric spaces. Okay, of course, in metric space, the two concepts coincide. And, there is a mistake, notation. Is forward, backward, is motivated by the following consideration. If you denote the state of an object at the time n by xn, then the future forward state is xn plus 1. Then q of xn, xn plus 1 is the cost to change from xn to xn plus 1. Okay? If the expected ideal state is x infinity, then the cost to change from the current state to the ideal state is q, which is called the forward cost. So this is used in this behavioral sciences. Okay, and so from this you have also the question of forward Hausdorff, backward. You have to be very careful when you are establishing a result in which way you are doing this. Okay, so you have forward Hausdorff, forward complete, backward complete, etc., etc. Okay, and you have also forward backward complete. For example, forward backward. Complete if every forward Cauchy sequence is backward convergent. You know? So you have to play with variables. Okay? And people who work on this in respect to the behavior science, it's difficult for me to pronounce this term, are Bao, Mandukovic, but Soubiran, which is a mathematician from the south of France, who is devoted to, since many years, to work on...
he's been here, Antoine Soubiran.
Maybe.
Juan Enrique.
He has worked with Juan Enrique also. He is interested in this, and so they prove this theorem. For instance, if you have a forward complete and forward Hausdorff quasimetric space, and find a set-value mapping which satisfies, okay, this condition, which was the condition we have already seen in the previous slide, then for every point x naught, there is a generalized Picard sequence xn starting from x naught and forward converging to an invariant point of phi. So you can obtain in this way fixed point theorem for in the setting which is not the setting of metric spaces, more general, and which can be applied to this sector of sciences. Okay? And so I will now give you the main result we obtain with Bao in this direction, which is the theorem Sun, as now, which is an unified version of the DHMP MFPT theorem. So now we are in a quasimetric space. You have a set-value mapping, xk a generalized sequence, Picard sequence. Okay, you remember this, and you assume that you have this condition, phi of xn plus 1 is included in phi of xn. So you have already seen this condition, that the supremum over x belonging to phi of xn of q of xn x goes to 0 when n goes to plus infinity. You have some x bar which belongs to all of the phi of xn, and xn has at most one forward limit, then the intersection of all the phi of xn reduces to the singleton x bar, okay? And where x bar is this guy, here, in E3, okay? This is the main result of this paper. And it is a unified version of the fixed point theorem due to DHM. Okay? And if also you have in addition this condition E5, then X bar is a non-invariant point, and it becomes an invariant point provided phi of X bar is non-empty. Okay? Then, I can skip this. I can also skip this, which is more okay. I don't know what time is it. Okay. This is more technical. Okay, so now we can prove by combining from theorem sum, we can obtain an extension of this theorem here. Baumol-Lukovich-Subera. Okay, theorem two notes, because this. Okay, and sun, because this. And from, you remember this theorem of, just to check again, the slide. Okay, and from this, combining the two, we can obtain what I call all sequence version of theorem sun, which is the following. If you have X, Q, a quasi-metric space, phi, a self-valued mapping which satisfy this condition which is now familiar to you, any forward Cauchy general Spica sequence has at most a forward limit, F3, L4, for each generalized Picard sequence xn, the limit of q of xn and xn plus 1 equals 0, then you have an invariant point, okay, which means that phi of x bar is included in x bar, and if phi of x bar is non-empty, then it is an invariant point. So this, in fact, is a generalization, okay, is an extension of this, this theorem. Okay? Okay, so so I skip this because it's a little bit technical. And now we will prove that this result, theorem sum, also imply the theorem of Q I give at a certain moment, and also the, it extend the theorem of Kahn and Kui, which was given also before. Okay, and I will end the lecture with a quasi-metric version of the Eklund variational principle for given by Bordukovich, Baum, Bordukovich, and Subirin in set-value analysis recently in 2015. It has been published recently. If you have X, a forward complete quasi-metric space in which forward convergence sequence has a unique forward limit, and if you take a function phi which is bounded, extended real value, bounded from below and decreasingly lower semi-continuous, okay, now we are talking about functions, okay, but now the setting is no longer a metric space, okay, you have a quasi-metric space, and the setting is forward complete. Okay? Not complete, forward complete. So all this is very weaker, is weaker than the usual assumption on Eklund. And you have phi, an extended real valued function, which is proper, okay? Not always equal to plus infinity, which is bounded from below and decreasingly lower semi-continuous. What does it mean? It means that for every forward convergence sequence xn with forward limit x bar, which satisfy phi of xn plus 1 less than phi of xn, so it is decreasing, One has that at the phi of x bar is less than equal to phi of xn. So the limit is less than phi of xn. So I call this decreasingly lower semi-continuous. Okay. Then for any lambda strictly positive and x naught in the domain of phi, so it means that phi of x naught is finite, there is a x star in the domain such that you recognize something familiar with the Eklund variation principle. Phi of x star plus lambda q x naught of x and x star is less than equal to phi of x naught. And for every x different from x star, then phi of x plus lambda q of x bar x star x is strictly greater than phi of x bar. So if you go to the first or second slide, you recognize what is inside the conclusion of the Eklund variation principle. So from this theorem, we can derive, I will not say easily because we have to, prove the main result, but when you have the main result, you can prove easily this version, weaker version, I will say, but not so strong, of course, but weaker version of the Eklund variational principle. Okay, and in fact, the proof is very easy when you obtain the theorem sun. Okay. You have just to define the right, given the function phi, small phi, you have just to define the good multifunction capital phi, okay? And then verify that for this multifunction capital phi, the condition F1 to F4 of the theorem Sun, which is here, okay, to verify that all these conditions are satisfied. And then you derive the result, okay, which is this one, which is a nice result. Okay? So I will say that as a conclusion, I am on time, one hour, okay? The main result of this presentation is theorem Sun, which provides an extension of the Danks Hedgedus Medvedev fixed point theorem, which not only unifies several result generalized version of this theorem, Kui, Kahn, and so on, but also, and Bordukovich and Bao also, and Souberan, but also further extend them to the quasi-metric space setting. And I hope that you can think after this lecture that this setting of quasi-metric space is an important setting for application in directions that were me, but probably you also, were not used to work. Okay? Muchas gracias por su atención. And thank you, not too much. So this is the paper of Danks Hedgedus Medvedev theorem. Okay? And this is the paper of Bao, Mordukovich and Souberan. Okay, where they are working on this application, capability theory of well-being, okay, via variation, what they call via variational rationality, okay, and this is a paper, in fact, now it is published in optimization, okay, it's a special issue dedicated to Franco Giannese. Uh-huh. Okay? Thank you very much for your attention. Again.
Is there any question, remark?
So I need to drink a little bit.
I can say something. I guess that maybe in some proofs this phi function may assign to each point a ball with a radius depending on the point, or a quasi-ball, or is it? Because I see that some of the theorems are quite general with a multifunction phi, but sometimes when you do a general statement, you are thinking in a more particular one. I saw some applications there with this, let's say, lower sets, but I think it can be used with these ideas of assigning to each point a ball with a radius depending on the point. Is it in size?
I don't really follow you, but in fact, there are many concepts in this, but the idea are very common, because always, but it is a fact with Eklund since the beginning, you have to construct inductively sequences which are converging in some way, and so you are using the tools you have in your hands. For Eklund, it's the tools of completeness, Cauchy sequences, completeness, and so on, and or the what we call in France decreasing intersection property. You have construct a set, and when the a sequence of closed sets which are decreasing and the intersection is not empty, and so on. And so then when you are using this concept of forward or backward Cauchy sequences, quasi-metrics, the idea are very similar, but you have to be very careful and in the way to use them, because you have to be careful and observe which are the variables you are using, because you have no symmetry.
What I was trying to say is that sometimes there are some standard arguments which can be reformulated with the language of multifunctions.
For example, sometimes you
consider a sequence of balls. But if you decide to assign to each point a ball, you are constructing a multifunction, and maybe you can embed a classical result with a new language.
Okay, I understand more now your question.
Because I was also thinking when you talked about quasi-distance, it is not the first time we listen to this concept. I remember when Natalia Jonar was here, she told, for instance, that when he went from his house to the gas station, the distance was lower than when she had to come back, because the one-way direction.
Exactly. So, it's exactly what I say. That sort of
I remember this. But I was also thinking about house of distance. It is divided into are they quasi distance? Yes, the two excesses maybe.
I didn't check. I should say that I should confess that I didn't think about that. But it's effectively we can. We can look, probably we can generalize in some way some other result, and For instance, this is a good idea. Yeah.
You can work with hyper typology. If you
exactly.
consider a closed set as a point, and then you can consider sets contained on this one plus the ball, or sets containing this set minus the ball.
No, it is a very good idea, because, for instance, in optimization we are very interested when studying stability property of convergence, for instance, Hartree-Schwarz convergence, what we call Hartree-Schwarz convergence, which is related to the outdoor distance, or this Moscow convergence, or this kind. But they are related to distances. And in fact, I don't know any work, but maybe they exist, I didn't check on the internet, where instead of using a distance, you use a quasi distance, and maybe you can obtain some convergences of kind of Hartree-Schwarz, and which induces some stability property for optimization problem. Or this is a good idea. I didn't.
These are only ideas, but okay. I was also thinking if you consider quasi distance, this could be give you a language for considering lower semi-continuity and upper semi-continuity with the same point of view. Let's say it depends on the distance. If you don't allow big shrinking or big explosions of sets, so I think.
So we have to start.
No,
after lunch. But it's a good idea. One is a good idea.
I found your talk very.
You see, this is a thing which is very interesting when you are experimenting your research with other people, because sometimes you arrive to new ideas that you had not in mind. And this is a good idea, really, thank you.
We like all this stuff, as the people from Murcia, this stuff is lovely. Okay, so
thank you.
Thank you again.